Hi students, I welcome you all for control system lectures. In the previous class, we have given introduction to the second unit, that is time domain analysis. In time domain analysis, we have discussed the standard signals like impulse, step, ramp and parabolic signals. So we have derived the expression for all the four signals, and also we discussed what is the first order process and what happens if I am giving all the standard signals to the first order process. And what is the response that indicates, and like how the dynamics varies if different input signals are given to the first order process, right? So we discussed how it behaved, right? First order process, we saw the transient and the steady state of the first order process, and in continuation to that, and we'll be discussing on second order system in this class, right? As the main difference of a first order system and the second order system is the denominator factor, maximum order of the denominator, right? The S factor. In the first order process, it is observed that the denominator factor or order is a power of 1. So here, since it is a second order process, if you see the denominator factor of S, the maximum order is 2. So that is how the name, the term, it is referred as a second order process, right? So here actually, if you observe the first order process, we have seen the transient and the steady state, right? Transient is something, it is varying with respect to time, and steady state, it is the point from where the system response is constant, right? So, but what if the system is having some dynamics of oscillations, right? It can go randomly, or it will be having some kind of oscillations, right? To capture that kind of dynamics, it is important for us to consider second order systems, right? So here mainly there are two important terms, omega n, that is a natural frequency, and gamma, right? It is a damping factor. Right, it is referred as eta, right? This is eta, which is referred as a damping ratio, and omega n is natural frequency, right? So what happens now, the point here is the point where the system tends to oscillate, right? The natural frequency omega n, if you observe here the equation is referred as omega n square by s square 2 zeta omega n plus omega n square. So here natural frequency represented as omega n, it is the frequency at which the oscillations refers to the frequency where the oscillations exist in the system, right? Damping ratio is something, it is a dimensionless parameter which describes how the oscillations or the vibrations comes to zero. See, if you observe the first order plant, we have a transient response where it started with the zero initial state and had some transient and reached the final state, right? But when you are considering the oscillations, when you are having the oscillations in the process, the transient response, the variation with respect to time, transient response should be oscillatory, and the steady state remains as same as the first order process, right? When we go into the, like when we start deriving the second order process and the description, when we are explaining about the poles and zeros, then it will be clear for you how these parameters like omega n and zeta influencing the plant response, plant output, right? Now we'll start deriving the poles of the system, and we'll check with these parameters of omega n and zeta, and see how the system responds to that, right?
Fine. So let us consider the second order equation. The equation 1 you can see here, this is the differential equation of the second order, since the order of the differential equation is 2. Right, it is a d square x by dt square. The order, maximum order is 2. Therefore, this is the second order equation, differential equation. So, if you observe the coefficients of a differential equation is a2, a1, a0, and b0 are the constant terms. right? And the outputs are x. Here you can see x is the output and y is the input, right? Once we apply the Laplace transform to equation 1, so you get this equation, right? You can see the equation here, a2s square x of s, a1s x of s, a0 x of s, b0 y, right? This is actually the Laplace transform of different second order differential equation, right? What is the transfer function? Transfer function is Laplace transform of output to input, right? So, Laplace transform of output by input. Output is x of s and input is y of s. Segregate the x of s term, take the common of x of s terms and send it on right side and send this b naught on left side and you can do the reciprocal of it, right? What we need is x of s by y of s. You can take the common of x of s, send the remaining terms on the right side and bring back the x of y of s term on the left side. Right. So therefore, the second order equation, you can see it in the equation 2. This is the second order equation, right? As I mentioned in the slide, the important terminologies of second order equation is omega, n and zeta, which is the natural frequency, the frequency at which the oscillations starts. You can observe the oscillations. Like in the system, if you observe the oscillations at a particular time point, those oscillations are referred as natural, the frequency at which those oscillations occurs is called a natural frequency, right? Damping factor, it is a point at which the oscillations comes to an end, like it will come to zero, right? What we'll do, we'll take a closed loop equation, this is just to represent the second order equation. So, we have to represent this A0, A1 terms in terms of natural frequency and damping factor. So, let us consider a closed loop equation. Right? Omega n square divided by S into omega n square divided by s into s plus zeta omega n holds, like this. So this is actually the Plant second order equation, open loop second order equation. C of s is the output, will take a unity feedback, give to this minus plus r of s, right? So applying the closed loop equation, if this is g of s, g of s by 1 plus g of s h of s is the closed loop equation, right? So just apply that and write down this in terms of a closed loop equation, right? T of s is equal to C of s by r of s. That is equal to omega n square divided by s square plus 2 zeta omega n plus omega n square. If you write the equation for a closed loop, you will get this equation. You can just solve it. It is nothing but g of s by 1 plus g of s h of s. H of s is 1, and you can just put that g of s and calculate closed loop equation, right? So you will get this equation. We'll take this equation, and so you can observe here. So zeta, right? Here actually zeta is a damping factor, damping ratio, and omega n is actually natural frequency, right? So what we'll do now is, if you observe this equation, we need to find the characteristic equation. So engineering mathematics, if you would have gone through engineering mathematics, how to find the characteristic equation of any system? Characteristic equation, if you're having a polynomial equation, the denominator polynomial, we have to make it to zero, right? So what is the denominator polynomial here? S square plus 2 zeta omega n s, here actually I missed s, yeah, s is there, okay, plus omega n square is equal to 0, right? So what we'll do here, actually the coefficient of s square is actually nothing is there, I mean it is actually 1, so we'll take the coefficient as a, because when you are solving a problem in numerical problems you'll be getting the coefficients, so for that sake we'll make it as a, you know, common point for all, like we'll find the roots, and if you have any coefficient value it'll be easy for you to just substitute the value. That's sake we'll take this like one as a and this one as b and this one as c, right? So s square coefficient, s coefficient and constant like a, b, c, right? So what is the roots of complex numbers? If you want to find the roots, so how you find the roots of roots of denominator? Usually the formula for roots, to calculate roots, how you do? The denominator factor, second order equation, minus b, for quadratic equation how you do? Minus b plus or minus root of b square minus 4ac by 2a, isn't it? So we have b here, a and c, right? We'll be having abc from the second order denominator, second order equation, denominator we have, and we'll be substituting those terms, right? We'll substitute those terms and we'll calculate the roots, right? So what is b? B is 2 zeta omega n, right? That is equal to minus 2 zeta omega n plus or minus root of, so here actually if you observe 2 zeta omega n is right, 2 zeta omega n whole square minus 4 is there, no? What I'll do? I'll make this 4 as 2 square, because c you have as c is omega n square, like a is 1, a is equal to 1, c is omega n square, and you have 4, what I will do, I will make it as 2 square, so what happens, 2 into omega n whole square, because a is 1, right, a is nothing but 1, and c is omega n square, and 4, 2 square, right, so what is the roots now? Root is nothing but, you can take, see here actually root, you'll get 4 here, you'll get 4 here, you can take common of that 4, since it is root, when it is coming outside, it is 2, right? So what happens if it is coming from outside the root, it is actually 2a, 2, right? Here 2 is there, here you'll get 2 again outside, we'll take common of 2, and you have a denominator 2, will get cancelled out. So what is the equation you get at the end? Zeta omega n plus or minus omega n square, right? Like omega n, we'll take it common because the square is there, 2 omega n, right? A square minus b square, a plus b into a minus b, right? So we'll be what you get here is omega n, you are keeping it outside, so zeta square minus 1, isn't it? Minus, right? So this is nothing, these are nothing but roots. I'll make this as s1 comma s2, S1 comma S2 are roots, and these are the roots, right? So we found the roots now. So important point here to note it down is actually now we are making the roots in terms of zeta and omega n. What is zeta? Zeta is damping and omega n is natural frequency. And we are framing the relationship in terms of zeta and omega n, right? Now note down the important points here. Important point, damping is something. So based on the damping here, omega, zeta value, based on that zeta value, we need to check the performance of the system, how the system behave based on the zeta. See, because if you see the second order, actually equation of the second order, it is omega n square s square 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. The important factor which is influencing the relationship of output input is, there are factors like omega n and zeta. Now we will frame the relationship with respect to zeta, right? So if zeta is equal to 0, then the system is called actually undamped system. Undamped system. If the zeta value is lying in between, these are beta value lying in between 0 and 1, then the system is underdamped. So how this undamped and underdamped is proposing based on zeta value, we'll be seeing when the step input is given to the system, second order system, and we'll see the behavior of the system output based on this damping factor. Then you will understand how actually the damping influencing. Like for time being, you just remember the zeta values as this way 0. When it is 0, let it be undamped. When it is lying in between, it is underdamped. And when it is equal to 1, it is critical damped. Critical damped system. And if it is greater than 1, it is actually overdamped. So damping gives the relationship of oscillations, remember. So when there is a oscillations in your system, it is referred in terms of a damping, right? So how this damping actually influence your system output? Like in which way or at what values of zeta you are getting the oscillations when you are giving certain input to the system, right? You got the roots, right? You can see here. So roots are S1 and S2 are minus zeta omega n plus or minus omega n zeta square minus 1. This is actually the roots, two roots. Substitute zeta is equal to 0 here. Right, when you substitute zeta equal to 0, this will be 0, right? So 0 square minus 1. Minus 1 actually, when your root of minus 1 is actually j square is equal to minus 1, right? Since it is root, I can take this as j. Okay, just I'll repeat it once again. When the zeta value is equal to 0, substitute the zeta is equal to 0 in this equation, in the roots, and observe what you are getting here. Right? Case 1. When zeta is equal to 0, roots S1, S2, that is equal to plus or minus j omega n. How it is j omega n plus or minus j omega n? See, here actually zeta is equal to 0, this will be 0, this will be 0, and here zeta is 0, this will be 0, but you have root of minus 1. Minus 1 can be represented as j square. Minus 1 is equal to j square is equal to minus 1, right? Complex j square is equal to minus 1, and j is equal to root of minus 1, right? So that way you get omega n into j. So when zeta value you are substituting it as 0, what are the roots? Plus or minus j omega n. So these are purely imaginary, right? There is no real term in this. So these roots are purely imaginary roots. So I'll take case 2 when zeta is equal to 1. What happens when zeta equal to 1? Critical damped, I mentioned critical damped when zeta is equal to 1. Just observe here, when substituting zeta equal to 1, what you get? Minus omega n, right? 1 minus 1, it is 0. So this will be eliminated. So what you get is just minus 1, right? Now there is no j term, so the roots are purely real, isn't it? So substitute zeta is equal to 1 in the roots equation. What you get? S1, S2 is equal to minus omega n. This is purely real, right? This is purely imaginary, right? Then two more cases are there, right? When the zeta is lying in between 0 and 1, and when zeta is greater than 1. So case 3, when zeta is greater than 1, so what I told, when zeta is greater than 1, greater than is 1 is under overdamped, right? Overdamped. When like you can choose any value and substitute zeta greater than 1, like you can substitute some 2 or something, some value of zeta which is greater than 1. So what you get is roots, that is S1, S2, that is equal to minus zeta omega n plus or minus omega n root of zeta minus 1, right? Just see that equation. Substitute the values which are greater than 1. See, any value you substitute which is greater than 1, you will get this equation, okay? So, I mean, if you want to get the under case with overdamped system, zeta should be greater than 1, and just substitute that, any value you can substitute in this equation to get the roots, right? In case 4, when zeta is lying in between 0 and 0 less than 1, right? If this is the case, you can choose any value in between 0 and 1, then substitute it in roots. Just check how it will behave, right? Now S1, S2 is equal to minus zeta omega n plus or minus j omega n root of 1 minus zeta square, actually, right? This is important. This I will take it as omega damping frequency, omega d. Damping frequency. So S1, S2 is equal to, S1, S2 is equal to minus zeta omega n plus or minus j omega d. Right? So these are actually complex conjugate. Roots are complex conjugate. Right, you just remember this. Once we solve for step input, then the way where we will use this zeta values, you'll be understanding. Right, once we start giving step input or impulse input to the system, so to the second order system, we have to consider the zeta value, like where the zeta is lying actually. Right, so let us start solving for unit step. Right, so we'll take unit step response for second order system using unit step. Using unit step. In unit step. Right, what is the system? T of s is equal to omega n square divided by s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. Right, so this is the second order equation. So let us consider the case studies now. Right, let us take the case study. Suppose if you are taking zeta is equal to 0 and damped system. When zeta is equal to 0, just substitute zeta equal to 0 here. What you get? T of s is equal to omega n square divided by this whole thing will become 0, s square plus omega n square. Right? So this is nothing but C of s by R of s. Now what we are trying to do is we are giving step input. So R of s is nothing but 1 by s. In first order, in the last class we discussed about the step input. When you are giving step input to the system, R of s in the Laplace domain is 1 by s. So when you are calculating C of s is equal to R of s is 1 by s, and write it down, R of s into omega n square divided by s square plus omega n square. What is R of s? It is 1 by s. 1 by s into omega n square divided by s square plus omega n square. Right? So what we'll do, we need to do partial fractions. Partial fractions, right? So we'll in the first case we'll do step by step, and the second case it is easy, we'll directly do it, or once you understand you can only do yourself. Like in first case I'll explain you a by s plus so b s plus c, right? Since s square is there, we'll take this way, s square plus omega n square, right, which is equal to, what is this numerator, which should be equal to omega n square. From where it is coming? What is the numerator? Omega n square, right? So we need to equate this numerator term to the omega n square. So just check it, how the equation will turn. A, the denominator, s square plus omega n square plus b, bs plus c into, here actually s, right, divided by s into s square plus omega n square, right? Now we should equate this numerator to omega n, right? Just equate it and solve for abc. Just solve for abc by equating it to omega n by comparing. So for that sake I'll tell this equation as 1, just for comparison. This I'll take it as 1, right? This will take it as 2. Now compare 1 and 2. Omega n square is there, numerator. Compare what we get here, right, omega n square. So we have only omega n square which should be compared. And if you see a values, if you observe, there is only one, right? S square, a into s square plus a into omega n square, right? If you are comparing this with a, omega n square coefficient is a. Here the coefficient of omega n square is 1. So therefore a is equal to 1, right? Now a into s square plus a into omega n square plus b into s square plus cs, right? Now if you observe s square coefficients, here s square coefficient is there, here s into s is s square. So if you take common of s square, what is a plus b? We don't have any s square on left side, right? We don't have any s square, so it is 0, right? Just substitute a in this one, what we get? B is equal to minus 1, right? Now c coefficient is what? C is the quotient of S. Is there S term here? No. So C is equal to 0. Right? Substitute ABC in equation 2. Substitute A comma B comma C in 2. What we'll get? Substitute and check it. So that equation will turn into 1 by S plus minus S by S square plus omega n square is equal to 1 by S minus S by S square plus omega n square. Isn't it? So this is the final equation. By apply inverse Laplace transform. So what we need to get is time domain equation, right? So we need to get in terms of a time, the function of time. So C of t is equal to Laplace, inverse Laplace of 1 by S minus S by S square plus omega n square. So just check with the equations. 1 by S is actually 1, right? Step. Right, inverse Laplace of step 1 minus, so this is in terms of S by S square plus A square. So we can write as cos A means A is what? Omega n t. So you should know the formula S by S square plus A square, that equal to cos A t. You need to remember this. Right, so I think you can check with the formulas of all Laplace to inverse Laplace formulas, so that it will be easy for you to write down and convert Laplace into time domain. So this is only for, this is for step input, right? Step is only for t greater than or equal to 0, right? So if you draw the plot, how it looks is this. Right. So cosine plot, 1 minus cosine, you will get it in this way. Similarly, what we did here, we took zeta is equal to, so from where we started, you just check it again. See, what we are trying to do is, for when zeta is equal to 0, zeta is equal to 0, we are applying a step input to the second order system when zeta is equal to 0. Right? Second order system, when zeta is equal to 0, we will get this. That is nothing but the transfer function. We know R of S is the step input, that is 1 by S. Just substitute 1 by S here. Then do the partial fractions and obtain the values of ABC. Substitute ABC to get the final Laplace equation, right? In terms of see, we are writing in this way so that we can easily convert the Laplace domain into time domain. We are doing this just to convert. We are making in terms of 1 by S minus and like in this kind of form, from the multiplication form, from this to this we are doing. The reason of doing is it is easy for us to convert later. Right. So this is when zeta equal to 0. So consider case 2. See, I will be giving the final values since for time as a time constraint, I will just give the final value. It is just a substitution. You can just substitute it and check it. Right. Zeta for underdamped, zeta should lie in between 0 and 1. I will give the final value of C of t. You can just solve. It is as same as the procedure which we followed there. Just substitute the zeta value, some zeta value in between 0 and 1. and apply the step input. That means apply 1 by s, C of s by R of s, you need to apply 1 by s and solve for the partial fractions and obtain in terms of a convertible form, which will be easy to convert the Laplace domain to a continuous domain, I mean t, time domain. Right, this is the final equation. I'm just giving the final equation. You can just solve it and I can cross verify it. Right. So sine omega t plus phi. So here actually omega t is omega n root of 1 minus zeta square, and phi is equal to tan inverse of 1 minus zeta square by zeta. Right? So this is the equation when the zeta is lying in between 0 and 1, that is underdamped system. Right, when the system is underdamped, the response you get is this one. C of t, t. Right, you can just solve it yourself. You can just substitute the value in between 0 and 1 in the second order equation. Right, give the step input, that is 1 by s, substitute 1 by s in R of s, then solve and derive the expression in time domain. Then when it comes to critical damped, that means zeta is equal to 1, critical damped, right? And zeta is equal to 1, C of t is equal to 1 minus e of omega n t into 1 plus omega n t, right? This is the response you may get if you are substituting zeta is equal to 1. Just you can substitute and try yourself. Right, then this is the case for zeta is equal to 1. Then when the zeta is greater than 1, so you get C of t is equal to 1 minus omega n divided by 2 root zeta square minus 1 of e power minus s t by s. This is actually s1 I'll take, minus e minus s2 divided by s2. Right, this is the expression where what is the s1 s2 values here, where s1 is equal to zeta omega n minus omega n root of zeta square minus 1. What is s2? S2 is zeta omega n plus omega n of zeta square minus 1. Right, this is just a complex conjugate. Right, well, if you know one, you can compute the other one. Right, now the plot looks in this way. If you are calculating for zeta is equal to 1.5, this is the response. And when you are increasing the zeta value, you will get this kind of responses. This might be for 2, 4.5, right? When your zeta value is increasing, then amplitude will come down. So this is the expression for derivation for step input. When you are giving step input the plant, how the second order system behaves, right? Similarly, we'll do for impulse input. Time response of second order system when you are applying unit impulse. Okay, what is unit impulse? R of t is equal to del of t. When you are doing it in terms of s domain, R of s is equal to 1, right? So when you are substituting C of s by R of s, you will get only the second order equation. What is G of s is equal to C of s by R of s, that is equal to omega n square divided by s square plus 2 zeta omega n s, omega n s plus omega n square. So here actually R of s is 1, right? C of s is equal to same thing. Since it is 1, we will get the same thing. Okay. So that is the expression for C of s. Now we will do for the cases. So in a second order equation, basically you have to choose the zeta value, right? You have to choose the zeta value. Based on the zeta value, your system output will vary. Your system output is dependent on zeta and omega n actually, right? For different set of zeta values, you have to compute how your system behaves actually, right? Case one, right? When the system like underdamped, that is undamped, zeta is equal to 1. So substitute zeta equal to 1 here, what you get is C of t. C of t is equal to L inverse of C of s. It is nothing but L inverse of omega n square. Substitute zeta equal to 1, you get s square plus omega. First case we will take undamped and zeta is equal to 0, not 1, right? We will do 1 also. In the second case we will do zeta equal to 1. So what you get, Laplace inverse of this looks like a square by s square plus a square. So when you get the Laplace form of a square by s square plus a square, the time equation, that is C of t, is equal to omega n sin omega n t, is for t greater than or equal to 0, right? So this is in terms of a square by s square plus a square, right? This is in terms of that, and this is the equation sin omega n sin omega n t. It is a sin omega a, right? So this is the expression you get when zeta is equal to 0. So for values of different values of t, since it is a tie, it is actually sine wave, how you get is this, right? C of t and t, right? This is the expression you will get for different values of t. Since it is a sinusoidal function. So we'll do the second case, case 2. C of s is equal to same thing, omega n s square by s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. Substitute zeta is equal to 1. What you get is s square plus 2 omega ns plus omega n square, right? A square plus 2 ab plus b square. See, when you are substituting this value as 1, what happens? S square plus 2 omega ns plus omega n square. Doesn't it look like a plus b whole square form? Right? A plus b whole square. Right? Then apply inverse Laplace transform. C of t, this is again a square by s plus a whole square. right? So omega n square plus omega n square plus t, not plus actually, omega n square t into e power minus omega n t. So this is the form. If you have the Laplace of a square by s plus a whole square, right? If I substitute the values of different t and assume the natural frequency, you get this kind of response. When you are assuming the natural frequency, make sure that the natural frequency is same for whatever the assumptions made for all the cases, right? So this is how the response, I mean, this is how you get the time domain equation when you're applying for impulse and making the zeta value. See, if you observe the previous class, in the step there is no much complexity, but when you're coming to the second order equation, you have much more complexity in obtaining the step response model or impulse response model, right? Because it includes different functions, like you have more than two functions involved in the second order equation. So you have to consider in which combination of output you get, in which combination of parameters, like zeta and zeta is equal to 1 or 0. It depends on that, your output will vary. So you have to choose that. So, okay, fine, then here we'll stop it for today's class and we'll continue in the next class. Right?
Yeah, that's it about the second order system. So we have derived the second order system and we gone through the topics of zeta and omega n, how the zeta and omega n influences the system output, and we also derived the expression of output when the standard input signals are given to the second order system, right? So that's it about the topic. We'll meet you in the next class. Thank you.